welcome to the Cannabis Co-op promotional video. If you don't know anything about cannabis, you're about to learn a lot about it. In the 1930s, it was made illegal by a group of banksters and corrupt politicians in order to make sure that the bigger industries for petrochemicals and that got a foothold and they wiped out hemp. In 1961, the United Nations, led by the United States, Harry Anslinger, made the plant illegal just about in every country in the world. It's now, the Berlin Wall has come down, and we're going to get back into growing hemp, and we're going to overgrow the system. Okay, so the hemp plant, this is why it's so amazing. Hemp leaf, you can juice that, you can eat it. Not too bad. You can put it in salad. It's a bit like wheatgrass, it's got a whole lot of amazing things in it. So a leaf a day will keep the doctor away. And this is what's called the head. So there's a little seed in here called the hemp seed. And when we pick that seed, we can crush it up and we can make it. It's a very good food. It has omega 3, 6 and 9 in it, and it's the best oil you can get. It's great for arthritis and many diseases. Better than fish oil because it's grown in beautiful clean soil at the health farm. And we crush that up and we put it in some oil and you can eat that. The other parts of the plant are the bast and the herd. So that's the bast, that's the outside, and the inside bit's the herd. So it's easy to remember, just call it a bast herd of a plant. So this is what makes our fibre. So I'm wearing hemp today, that's made from that fibre. And this is what makes cellulose and fuel and all sorts of other amazing things which you'll also see in our tour of the hemp farm. So basically this is carbon. It's taken up carbon from the atmosphere, and if we turn into clothes and plastics and biochar and all sorts of other things, we can actually reverse greenhouse and save the planet. This is a tower, a growing tower. Basically what happens, we want to promote urban agriculture so we can free up our land to grow more hemp and bamboo to reverse greenhouse. It's got a little worm farm in the middle, so when you have your scraps, you can put your scraps in there and the worms eat up all the good stuff and turn it into compost basically. After you've watered it, you can simply take your water out, which drains through the system, and we can pour the water back on the top. That's all the nice worm juice back on the system, and it's sustainable. This one here, we just pull that out, all the worms fall down in the system, and we put the worms back on top of the system. So the sort of systems we want to create are sustainable in the areas that we're going. We don't want to be carting fertilizers and all that sort of thing thousands of kilometers. So a really good little system. As I said, you can grow a little bit of hemp in there, you can grow some medicinal herbs, all sorts of lovely things. This is my aqua hemp garden, and we've developed this for more for medical cannabis in the future. This is only industrial hemp here, but it's the same plant. So we've developed this garden to show people that they can grow medical cannabis and they can grow fish and use the whole thing to be sustainable. So it's what I call a biological garden. There's a lot of biology happening in there. So instead of using petrochemicals, we're using natural things like, for example, worms. You can see in here, in this little bin here, that there's some fungus growing there. So fungi is a really important food for plants. So that's the fungus. You can see some fungus growing there. Mm-hmm. So that fungus will break down into food for plants. And all this is just waste. So, you know, we've just seen ABC, the war on waste. What I reckon, we turn waste to wealth rather than having a war on waste. And what does the worm does all the work for us. So you see these lovely worms in here? They're doing all the work. And this garden, the worms are connected to the garden. So what happens is that the worms go down the garden, they take the food down to the roots of the cannabis plant and break it all up. So what we've got in here is, as I said, a biological garden. So we've got things like comfrey growing. It's also, we can just put that in our worm farm, that'll be eaten up. And we've got a little plant in here called water hyacinth. Now water hyacinth is an amazing plant. It has that root system, but it cleans the water basically. It can be turned into fuel, fibre, all sorts of amazing things. And it's got a little thing that cleans the plant. So in there, there's a whole lot of fibre and the water passes through that and it cleans the plant. So it's an amazing plant, and worms love it, chooks love it, and it cleans our water also and cleans the thing. So we put that in our worm farm, the worms will gobble it up and turn it into food for our plants. So there's no wastage in the system. The other plants we have in here is called vetiver plant. Vetiver is an amazing plant for cleaning up soil. It has a very deep root system, 3 or 4 meters deep, and we'll show you that right now. So that's the root system there. This is only a young plant. That actually cleans, that'll clean toxic water. You can see there's a worm on there that's crawled down inside the system. So it pumps oxygen into the water basically, and it'll clean the water, and animals and things like that will go down there. Like, same with this, we just cut that, put it back on the system. So what we're actually doing here is building humus, we're building fungi, we're building a biological system where the hemp plant's going to go really well, because all those little nodules on the hemp root are going to take up the minerals and everything that we put into the system. Basically, this system uses a number of things. We use biochar, which is basically charcoal. Now, biochar is an amazing thing. It's basically carbon. So what we've done, we've taken inorganic carbon, which is a tree or anything growing, and we turn it into inorganic carbon. So it can actually reverse greenhouse, because that carbon will take many hundreds of years to break down. So the carbon that's come into the plant, we've turned it into being an organic carbon, which breaks down quickly into basically an inorganic carbon. It will break down eventually, but it'll take many, many years to do so. So what we do is we activate that carbon, and then we put that in the soil also, and it becomes, it's like a Hilton hotel. It becomes a hotel for bacteria and fungi to live. And if we've got enough material in our garden, it will, you can see here, worms are just coming up here right to the surface, and they're feeding away, happy little worms. And the bacteria and fungi that's all in this garden now, it's a huge biological system. And the beautiful thing about that is we've got some worms here, we can just throw that in our pond to feed the fish. The other system we have, we turn our waste to wealth. We don't want to have a war on waste, we want to turn our waste to wealth. Is we've got, this is called a black soldier fly farm, and they're pretty amazing. Again, we put all our scraps in here. You can see it's pretty bloody horrible looking, isn't it? It's all mushy and smelly, and it's basically anaerobic. That's why it's quite smelly. But you can see in there, our little soldier flies. Now, soldier flies are an amazing thing. They can eat fish bones, rotten, putrid things, even more than worms. If you put a dead fish in there, it'll be gone in about 3 days. They're very vociferous. They eat stuff amazing. You see, they're all through there. Now, the worms won't survive in that because it's anaerobic. They don't like those conditions. But what the soldier fly does, this is a specially designed bin. It crawls up into that little hole there. It climbs up this little tower here. You can see that. It'll climb up there through that little hole and into there. It basically self-harvests. So what we do here is we get our little bin there. You can see the soldier flies in there. Yep, they just self-harvest. So we don't even have to harvest. So we just put our dirty old smelly stuff in there, food scraps and meat and all that sort of thing. And then we take that over here again. And we feed it to our fish. So we put it in there. So you can see in the system it's quite bubbly, there's a little bit of surfactant in there. The idea is we want to get as much oxygen into the system so the bacteria breed up. So we put some organic surfactant in there, which bubbles it up a little bit. And so this, when we put this out onto the garden, we'll create hundreds of millions of bacteria and fungi and all sorts of beautiful things in the soil. Most will be aerobic. Yep. So, the other thing we have in here in our water system is when fish poo, they make nitrites. We have to change it from being a nitrite to a nitrate. So we put it through the system here, our flow form system, and it flows through there. It flows through the biochar that we made earlier. Remember I said that's like a Hilton hotel? So that's filled with bacteria that switches it from being a nitrite to a nitrate. In other words, it switches it to a fertilizer for plants. And then we pump that water through our system. It comes back, cleans the water. So our water is always clean in here because it's been stripped of all the nutrients and the bacteria and fungi is all being used to feed the plants. We can also have a little high-rise system. So the water's going through this system here. Water's flowing through again like that, and it flows back in the system. So what we've got here is an enclosed aqua hemp system. We can grow really beautiful hemp in here because it's got the bacteria, the fungi, everything it needs. So when for medical cannabis, when we get it legalised, we'll be able to grow medical cannabis like this and grow the best best medical cannabis for people. Healthy water, healthy food, healthy soil. And that's what it's all about. Okay, this is a hemp stalk. It comes off one of the plants I grew here. It's pretty good size. I think it's about a 30 footer. We can make this into basically stubby carbon, like I was saying before. We can make that into biochar. What's locked in every piece of wood or anything that grows on the planet, what's locked in the wood is gas, usually methane, and it's trapped inside the wood. So when you boil a jug, you get steam. Basically what we're doing in this system, we're throwing wood on there like that, and the carbon will be retained in it, but the gases will get burned off. And it goes from being an unstable carbon, which it breaks down the atmosphere and releases methane and CO2, to a very stable carbon. It can last for thousands of years in the soil, and that becomes our Hilton hotel for our bacteria and fungi, so we can grow more biomass. And then we can do away with the mining industry and all those petrochemicals. So, what we do with this system, as you can see how red hot that is. So that's all our carbon. Now that can't burn in there because there's not enough oxygen for it to burn. So as we fill this thing up, we'll fill this thing all right up to the top, and it'll be full up to there. When we've put all that wood in there, it'll be full all the way up, and that'll be all be beautiful carbon. There's a few nails in there too, so we'll have a bit of iron in our soil as well. So we're going to throw a bit more on there, and we might come back and just see how that flames up. So basically what we do is we throw our wood in there. And that could be hemp or basically any bit hot. Try and leave a little bit of a gap there. It'll start to flame up in a minute because of all the heat there. And we might come back and have a look at that when it's roaring away. We'll go and visit the chookies in the meantime. Alright, now if you want to grow good cannabis, you have to have a chookie. This is Blackie. She's my main chookie. And she lays beautiful eggs every day, and she gives me manure as well. And she gives me company, don't you, Blackie? Hey, you're a good old girl. So she grew up actually in the cannabis patch. But what they do, they make the fertility for my garden. So what I do in here, pretty simple. We've got straw, we've got crusher dust, crushed rock. You sprinkle that on top of the straw. And we've got biochar. We sprinkle that on top of the straw. And you notice in here, well you can't notice on film of course, it's not very smelly even though it's been really wet and damp, because the biochar sucks up a lot of the smell. And not only that, it gets filled, the little bits the chooks will actually eat, so it goes through their system and they poop it out the other end because it doesn't digest in their stomach, but it actually cleans their guts out. And when it comes out the other end, it's got nitrogen and phosphorus and all sorts of beautiful things in it. And then we put it in our little compost tea brew system. So what we do, and we put a bit of cow poo in there too. Cows have two stomachs, so they've got lots of bacteria and fungi to break down the grass, because they eat a lot of carbon, it's very difficult to break down. So in there is all the necessary stuff we need to break down carbon to switch into food for plants. I need a bit of hand here. Where's my hand? Ah, sister! What you doing, sister? Give us a hand. Hold old Blackie for me.
Yeah.
She's been busy. She's been giving us eggs and all that stuff. So what we do, we get all the nice stuff from Fidel and Blackie and Goldie, and we basically, you hold that side there, beautiful. We basically get that like that, and we put it inside the bag. And then what we're going to do, we're going to actually breed up lots of, there's lots of bacteria and fungi in there already. When we put it in our compost tea brew with the flow form, it'll multiply. We'll go from being millions to billions, because there's lots of oxygen in there. So we put a little bit of extra crusher dust in there, because that's got our minerals. So we'll have mineralized water. So when the plants grow, we'll have beautiful mineralized, when we go have our hemp, it'll be beautiful mineralized organic hemp. And the problem with a lot of organic food that you buy today, it actually lacks minerals. You know, it's grown organically, but because we've leached all the minerals out of the soil, we don't get the minerals. So what we do by doing it this way, a lot of those minerals have turned into a liquid form, and they're blacking. And we grow beautiful hemp. So that's how we grow it.
Sounds interesting.
Oh, it is, huh? And proof's in the pudding, isn't it? Fresh eggs and lovely hemp. a bit more on here. A bit more saving Mother Nature. And then we can then put the thicker stuff on the top. Alright, it's not very hard to make biochar, so don't be put off by that drum. It's a little bit expensive, but all you need is a good old 44-gallon drum. Put some holes in the bottom, a few holes around like that. Fill it up, light the top, and you have your Hilton Hotel. So, if you haven't got a lot of money, get yourself a 44-gallon drum. Costs about $8. Couple of hours work, knock some holes in it, and you have biochar. When people grow it for medicinal use or for smoking, they pull out all the males. Alright, now the male itself has some really probably marvellous medicine. Can you see the little balls on the male? It's pretty obvious it's a male. When you shake it, all the little things come off. Mainly it's pollinated by wind. So the male will always grow taller than the female. So it sprinkles its little pollen over the female and it gets seeds, those little seeds in there. Now if the male doesn't pollinate the female, it doesn't get those seeds. Our biochar cone, as you said before, with all the ashes were down. So when we load some more wood into it, it starts to, there's a lot of heat underneath there obviously, and it starts to heat that wood straight away. And what's burning now is like a vortex. What's created here is it folds the heat back in, and there's not enough oxygen for the wood to burn, but there's enough heat for the gas to come out. So the gas is coming out of the wood and it's getting burned. So you can see the sort of, you can actually see it on some of these. So if I get my pitchfork, you might just be able to see the gas coming off there. See the little gas coming out? You see there, basically you can see that gas coming up now. So what will happen is all that gas will get burned out of the wood and it'll just leave our char again. The methane's gone and the thing's gone. So we can throw a bit more wood on there, Chiba, I reckon. So that carbon will actually take it up by the plant. So as that blows across my cannabis plants, the cannabis will take up the carbon in the fire and they'll extrude oxygen. This is if you want to make good cannabis, get biochar. Okay, the reason we're getting a cannabis co-op together is because we want to get people together to get this beautiful plant back in for everyone. If it's made from oil, gas or anything else, it's a hydrocarbon, it can be made from hemp and it can be made from plants. And that's the reason why it's illegal. As I said before, in the 30s, there was a conspiracy to make it illegal by the banksters and the industrialists and the politicians. Hundreds of thousands of people have been locked up and lost their whole careers and their lives, actually, for this beautiful plant, which does everything for us. Interestingly enough, cannabis is the only plant that can't actually kill you. You cannot overdose on too much THC or CBD. You can overdose on water, you can overdose on cabbages, but you can't overdose on cannabis. Interesting, isn't it? So why is it illegal? Well, if you want to know, get Jack Harrah's book. Jack Harrah was an activist in the United States, and really he was the man that put cannabis back on the agenda in America. So good on you, Jack. He's unfortunately left us, but he left a great thing I've read the book and I've just read so much about it. So Emperor has no clothes, and the Berlin Wall is coming down. So there's three main things that the Cannabis Co-op will be promoting. The industrial use of hemp, the medicinal use of hemp, and the food use of hemp. I call it IMF. The IMF was actually set up at the end of the Second World War to fleece the third world countries of the resources and played a big part in not directly making hemp illegal, but financing big mining interests. So all the stuff that comes from mining we can have from this plant. This is an amazing product. It's just hemp and water. Yeah? And that's all it is. And so it makes things like that. That's a vase made from hemp, just from hemp and water. And all these products here are made from hemp. So just simple hemp and water can make amazingly strong products. This is a little bowl made from hemp fusion. And we'll be actually going over to the factory and having a look at this today. So you can see it's very strong. It's actually pliable as well. And I can throw that really hard and no damage to it. And I can actually put it on the floor like that, stand on it, all good. The beautiful thing about that, I can put it in my compost bin and it'll turn back to earth. It'll go back to the earth. The other beautiful thing I can do with it is I can turn it into biochar, and it becomes stable carbon. So we've used the product for however long. We're sick of it. We want to get a new iPhone or something made from our biochar or from our cannabis, and we just put it back in the composting, or we turn it into biochar and put it back in the garden. All right, there's amazing things you can make from hemp. This is actually hemp mixed with wool, so we can mix it with other fibres. There's hemp insulation, so that can insulate your home. Beautiful, isn't it beautiful? Mwah. Lovely and clean, it's not toxic. You can rub it on your skin. Won't get like that horrible fiberglass stuff, you know, you get on your skin, it prickles you all up. That's just lovely and natural. I can even wash myself. Hemp rope, ultimately strong, unlike plastic, doesn't break down and stuff up our ocean. It just breaks down and the animals will eat it. And it'll last every bit as long as plastic as a usable product as well. Hemp bricks, we can build our home from it. We want to get out of the sun. We get out of the hemp patch, we can put our hemp pad on and keep cool. Anything that's made from petrochemicals and mining, we can virtually make from hemp and bamboo and other biomass products. But hemp is the best because it gives us such a wide variety of product, basically. And it's extremely strong. So, you know, we know what happened with hemp. As I said, they made it illegal. They hung it up. But we're back. Hemp clothes. My clothes I'm wearing are hemp. You see, really beautiful clothes. And last a long time. A good hemp shirt will last you at least 10 years. Most of the hemp shirts I wear them for 10 years and I go out farming in them and they get holes in them and then I make them into rags and then I'll make them into biochar or compost them. So after 10 years of good use, you can put it back in the thing. Unlike petrochemical clothes, which make the world toxic. We should be able to make our own medicines. I think everyone should be able to grow at least 8 plants a year and make their own medicine. Why go to a petrochemical company to get toxic medicine when you can make your own? This is a little magic butter machine. They're very good. They're very simple. You can just put in your contents, your herbs in there, and set the right temperature, put your 8-hour button, and 8 hours later you've got your own herbal medicine or herbal food, whatever you want to call it. So our herbs should be our food. Our food should be our medicine. If we eat good food grown in good water, grown in good soil, it's a medicine in itself. But even though we're finished with our hemp, we can actually turn the hemp into charcoal and it becomes a medicine. So we put that in there like that and it will detox your body. It's basically carbon, and we mix it up like that. Basically the toxins in your body, it'll detox your body. And they use it a lot actually in hospitals, not particularly hemp, biochar or charcoal, but they use charcoal in hospitals when people get poisoned. This is from the hemp leaf. Beautiful little cocktail there. The hemp leaf is pretty, actually better than a lot of the other little green drinks we get. So it's a beautiful, it doesn't taste that great, it tastes a bit like wheatgrass. So it's got some minerals. Because we've grown in really mineral-rich soil and good water at our health farm, you can mix it with things like ginger, and turmeric, which actually makes a health drink. So we can make our own health drinks. So hemp for health. And all this information's available at the Hemp Embassy too. Now, the last thing, as I said, our food should be our medicine. Hemp is actually the best food on the planet. It has omega 3, 6 and 9 in it, better than fish oil and cleaner because it's not come from a radioactive ocean, and it's really good for you. So there's what we call hemp protein, and this is a company called Love Hemp. They make a little company in Mullumbimby, and they make a very lovely product. This product actually comes from Tasmania. And so what you can do, make hamburgers from that, you can make pretty much anything. Lovely food, and it's a beautiful, beautiful product. So you can mix it up with other things, and it's high in protein. So for vegetarian and vegans, it's the perfect food. Yeah. The other beautiful thing from hemp, of course, is from the hemp seed. It's hemp seed oil. And we should be having at least a tablespoon a day. A tablespoon of hemp oil, a tablespoon a day, will keep the doctor away. So we just put in like that. Hemp seed oil, yum. It's lovely and creamy. You'll always know good hemp seed oil. If it's grown in Australia, it's usually pretty good anyway. But you'll know good hemp seed oil because it tastes lovely and creamy. If it tastes rancid, it means the oxygen has gone to it. Now, the other reason hemp seed oil is so very good for you, I actually have chronic back pain. I started taking this 2 years ago, and you can see me, I'm moving around. I used to wear a big leather belt, and as Chiba will testify, for about 7 or 8 years, I had a back operation about 15 years ago, and my sciatica nerve got pinched, and I ended up with a floppy foot, but I can actually operate. I used to wear a back brace. I've been taking this for about 2 years, and I credit this to making me mobile. I still get a sore back, but I'm mobile. So I have a tablespoon every day. Okay, Ben, so what's happening here in the lab? Looks solar panel. The sun's not showing, man, and you've got these, what are these things? They look like sort of something charcoal. From hemp.
So what we've been doing is we've been looking at hemp's ability to hold charge. As we've found that the char made from the hemp plant is able to actually hold a charge. So once we've been able to convert it from solar, wind, or even, you know, your car battery, it will hold a charge, and as a capacitor, and working as a capacitor, it will discharge as and when it's needed. So we've been working on how small.
Yeah. What's that stuff, man? That's pretty cool.
How small we can go.
Uh-huh. Is it like to do with surface area? So like, if you put that on your paper, does that give you like a place to store the energy?
Yeah, basically. Well, the carbon does. Yeah. The carbon does. So it's
so you put the carbon on the paper.
Paper's merely the structure.
Oh, yeah.
So yeah. So essentially, what we're looking at being able to do is convert these into things like wall panels, and
so you could sort of make that into a wall and store your energy in your wall. Yeah,
much like the, you know, the.
So instead of insulation, you have it like a power wall.
Yep, basically.
So Tesla, eat your heart out.
Pretty much. Or come and play.
Come and play. Yeah, we can
come and play.
We can turn the carbon into batteries.
Yeah, I mean the hemp carbon is looking like a really good mass to be able to store energy safely, cheaply, organically. It doesn't overheat. It doesn't explode. And yeah, we're getting to the point where lithium technology is sort of coming towards the end of where its capacities are, and we've got something that grows nicely in the ground.
So we could grow a house, put some solar panels on the roof, put that as insulation in our thing for our battery energy storage.
You could,
and
grow
then
if you
like carbon negative,
you could grow,
you grow your own house.
Grow your own lifestyle.
Wow. Why couldn't the Australian government, ABC, build a new age revolutionary play school out of hemp?
Well, I
teach the kids every morning from 7 till 8 on play school.
It's funny, Farmer Joe, that you ask that, but basically what you're looking at is there's no industry for it right now. Yeah. And the reason there's no industry for it right now is because the government have shot themselves in the foot.
But there could be an industry of education.
Well, yeah, very much so. And that's what it is. It is educational. It is health. Yeah. It is those things.
All right, I'm talking from Martin from Hemp Fusion. Martin, this is an interesting looking stuff. It's made from hemp, and I think a bit of my biochar, isn't it?
Yep.
From Nimbin. And tell us a bit about it.
What we're looking at is a hemp nanofiber molding matrix. I make it with a mill behind me, and the idea is to go down to a nanoscale level of fiber length and fiber diameter, where you got certain hydroxyl bondings that increase to such an amount that you can make structural materials out of it.
So okay. Now, there's just water and hemp, isn't it?
Water and hemp. So it's like nature. Nature builds trees. Trees are built by the tree builds the cellulose molecule, the microfibril fiber, and we go down to the microfibril nanofiber level and kind of make a modern paper mache, and just through entanglement and hydroxyl bondings, it's self-assembling to a structural material. But I would say, hopefully there are going to be larger applications for these kind of materials. And the industry is very new, and looking at the Australian fibre, hemp growing industry, there's a lot to be done,
sure.
We know, and but I do see future, and in the next 5 to 10 years, these materials are becoming a very important part of sustainable construction.
In terms of, I'm a farmer, how much material are you going to sort of need for development of an industry?
I could need a few tons a year. Mm-hmm. I need ultra short fiber. Normally, the stuff that processing doesn't need that much. Clean ultra short fiber, I could need 5 tons a year, maybe.
Yeah. And what would 5 tons be worth?
5 tons for me, 15, 20 grand, depending on quality.
Okay. And how many acres would you need to grow that 5 tons?
Yeah, maybe you could get that easily out of a hectare, if you do well.
1 or 2 hectares, yeah. So the other thing, obviously, is board, the board market, which is pretty huge.
Yeah, insulation for fibres.
Insulation for fibres,
yeah.
So do you see this product being made into a board form?
As a composite in a composite, yes, where you use the structural qualities of it. Yes.
Yeah.
Lot of possibilities.
And what about spraying onto a structure like a building or like a dome or something like that?
Look, again, larger applications, bigger amount of raw material in process, it's all part of the future. Renewable resources, and especially the quality of hemp fiber, they have their future. So
and as I understand it, you can actually use, obviously, hemp fibre is the longest and strongest, but interesting, it's actually in a nano form, isn't it? So you don't really need long fibre.
Mm-hmm.
But you can use, like, other fibres from paper and other products, too.
Yeah.
So we can look at, like, rubbish tips that have huge amounts of cardboard and paper and things like that, and it could be fused with hemp and made into
packaging
products or something.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thanks, Martin, and we look forward to seeing hundreds of tons used. Yep. The hemp farmers.
I'm sure one day, the next 10 years, it's going to happen.